let someone get your goat. There's plenty to go around for everyone. 103.3 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Great Scott!
The Great Scott Show.
And as they head into the final furlong, all of the other radio stations and radio hosts are left in the wake of a keen turn of speed by the Great Scott Show, the champion.
With Scott Prather.
Steal the show.
Hello, everybody. Good morning. Welcome in to the Great Scott Show. Middle of the week, Wednesday. I'm Scott Prather. Got questions. Everyone's got questions. Every team in the NFL playoff has questions. We'll do our best to answer some of those. We'll talk some hoops. We got open phone lines at 337-269-1077. And we got a co-host in the studio this morning, Nasty Nick.
Morning.
Nick Sheremy.
Yeah.
Is here. And he
missed
is.
Missed a lot.
He is. I mean, did you drink any caffeine yet?
No.
Well, do you drink caffeine?
I'm trying to lay off a little bit. Trying to work on my physical shape.
And caffeine has a negative impact
on
you?
Yeah. Okay. It tends to make me eat more.
All right. You look like you need a jolt.
Yeah. It was early morning. I'm working a lot.
I'm just glad to be
working
here.
Working a lot recently, but no, I'm good.
It's good.
Having a good
time.
Yeah,
we can't all just, take a year off and work, 10 hours a week and make millions like Sean Payton did this past year.
Man. That's the life, though.
Not bad, huh?
No, I mean.
Not bad.
I can't blame him. He got a Super Bowl ring. If he wants to do that, that's fine.
He wants to coach again. Which team will have the most appeal? And of those teams, which one will want to hire him? The Broncos have reached out. They want to talk to him. The Cardinals would not confirm or deny whether or not they wanted to. But when asked about it, the owner kind of smiled. I'm just here to tell you that if the Cowboys blow it in a playoff game, Mike McCarthy, despite all the wins, might get fired, and then you can put them up on the table. So there's a number of things to keep an eye on here. Let's assess each one. The Broncos. What are the pros and cons here?
For the Broncos or
for Sean Payton?
For Sean Payton, I mean, you got Russell Wilson. I mean, he wasn't great this year, but he could just be one good offense away from unlocking.
So you're listening. Wilson is a pro. He's kind of a pro and a con at this point.
Yeah,
right?
He is. He is. I would say that the defense is a pro. It's already kind of set up a little bit better. Now, I know Sean Payton's not a defensive guy, but that's all the better. He doesn't have to worry about.
Says he'd hire Vic Fangio, who used to be in Denver as the head coach. So the defense already likes the guy.
Yeah.
You would like, maybe they don't. I don't know. Maybe.
These are probably entirely different guys than the guys that were there under Vic Fangio anyway.
No, so. It was only like a year ago, bro.
Really?
Hackett didn't last a year.
I guess that's right.
It wasn't long at all.
I figured they had an interim coach for longer than that. I don't know. I don't know about the location, though. Like, Denver doesn't seem like a very... Something about Denver doesn't say Sean Payton to me. You
really?
Know what I'm saying?
I don't know. I mean, he grew up in the Midwest where it was cold.
Yeah,
well, no,
yeah,
actually,
Illinois.
he's from California. He kind of moved around a lot. He's been all over. But he does like Jimmy Buffett a lot. So
well.
maybe because they're friends. I don't know. I don't know. I mean, look, Denver, shoot, man. I mean, Brandon Stokely said of all the places he played, he wanted to live there. Peyton Manning.
Yeah.
That's where he resides.
It seems like a nice spot.
There's people that like to, they make it their permanent residence. So Russell Wilson, it's worth noting that after they fired Hackett, had two pretty good performances, which is weird.
Yeah.
You know,
a couple nice wide receivers out there too.
Yeah. I think a pro for Denver is you have new ownership that seems to be just spending lots of money. Like they're taking big swings. And so if Peyton goes there and he's like, take a big swing on me, they'll put down the money. And I think that's that is objective number one on Sean Payton's
mind. Oh, yeah, of
course. But the Broncos CEO said that a new coach will answer to him and not ownership. I don't know if that's that right there might be the red flag.
Yeah.
All right, what about the Cardinals?
Their
GM position is also open, which is interesting.
I think that's a pro, because I think that means that if Sean Payton gets hired first, then he can pretty much a la carte say who he wants as GM, and if they're available.
You don't think it would be the other way around?
Yeah, I think whoever's hired first will get to choose the other person.
So,
or we'll get at least a say in choosing the other person.
There's speculation that Jeff Ireland would be high on the list for Arizona as a GM, and if that's the case, well then that just feels like a package deal, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does feel like a package deal. I honestly think I'm going to say that I think Kyler Murray is a con in this. I don't think Sean Payton and Kyler Murray styles will gel at all. Although Sean Payton would probably be very good for Kyler Murray.
Murray's locked into the team for minimum 2 years.
But on the other hand, I think the supporting cast around Kyler Murray is very Sean Payton. Just a lot of guys who are quick, who can get their hands on the ball. I mean, you got D-Hop. I know Sean Payton likes good wide receivers. I think that's not a bad spot, but I think Kyler Murray is going to have to change.
That franchise has existed for over a century.
I know.
No coach has lasted more than 6 years.
That's insane.
Because they lose a lot.
That would track if Sean Payton still intends to retire.
I mean, the team's won 7 playoff games ever.
That's insane.
You know, and half of the 6 postseason victories during the Super Bowl era all came in 2008.
That Super Bowl running year. Yeah.
That's, I mean, half of them. Like, as far as franchises go, the Cardinals historically are, from a winning percentage standpoint, the worst.
Yeah.
Now, if you don't count newer franchises like the Texans, but shoot, the Texans, I don't know. They're probably close to 6 postseason wins at this point. I don't know.
I have no idea.
Now I gotta go.
Yeah, I gotta figure it out. Yeah. I think it's telling that we didn't even mention Houston as a landing spot for Sean, even though they fired Lovie Smith.
They have 4. So they're only 2 back of the Cardinals who have been around for over 100 years.
Yeah, and the Texans only been around for, 20 years?
Since 2001.
Yeah, so 21 years, 22 years.
So it's a place that has not had a lot of success.
Yeah.
But folks seem to like some of the guys in their front office. I think, you know, are the Bidwells willing to spend the money?
I don't know. It depends. I think it depends on what they think they'll be able to get out of Kyler Murray, and it depends on what they think that scheme would look like.
All right, some other openings. The Carolina Panthers.
It's familiar.
I mean, a division rival?
That'd feel really
bad. I feel
bad.
Like the Saints would be like, we're going to, whatever the asking price is, we're doubling it for
yeah.
you.
yeah.
You know what I mean?
There's no chance the Saints let that go lightly. So if he doesn't end up going there, it's going to be for a haul, like an absolute haul. But to be honest, I mean, we could do the pros and cons, but I want to quickly take a look at this from Carolina's perspective. Steve Wilkes is not that bad of a coach. He finished the season extremely strongly.
He got him playing hard for him. He got him playing hard.
Interim coaches tend to do that.
He got him playing hard.
I don't know.
I don't know what the pros would be for Payton, other than if, you know, Tepper wants to pay him the most money, but just from a roster standpoint.
There's nobody on the roster that I think really piques his interest.
Yeah. Yeah. Pros, you go into a lousy division, so you have a chance to compete right away.
Yeah.
The Colts. No one's really talking about the Colts.
Yeah. I don't.
Probably a long shot. Payton always talks about ownership and management, and you know who knows. I mean, Chris Ballard's still there at GM. He's done a bad job. Irsay is, you know,
weird.
He tells people he's hands off when he loves to meddle.
Oh man.
Yeah, I don't know. They also don't strike me, like, because I think money trumps everything, but they also don't strike me as the team that would be like, we're going to make you the highest paid coach in the league.
They're not, yeah, they wouldn't do that.
And what do they have at quarterback?
Nothing.
So all of
maybe Derek Carr soon.
A lot of stuff points to Indy as like, no. Now, here's an interesting one, Nick. What about the Texans?
Okay, so I was waiting to see if you would bring them up. I think that if the Texans get, they have the second pick. If they get a quarterback.
And the 12th pick.
If they get a quarterback, ideally like a Bryce Young,
But he would be the one getting that quarterback if he was there.
So I guess he would be hired before the draft then. Mm-hmm. I think
absolutely.
I think for Houston, and they got to try, right? I mean, your franchise is nothing. You can't even tank right.
You fired back to back coaches,
like
consecutive years. The GM that did that, Nick Cesario, not a ton of experience, has not done a good job. Made fun of Bill O'Brien when they made him GM. And he kind of deserved it for some of the trades he got and the return he got on some of those trades. But, like, it's not like this cat's done all that great. And so, to me, the only thing that would sway him to the Texans is making him the highest paid coach in the league.
Sure.
And if they did, then he'd be like, all right, let's work out a deal. But give him the 12th pick. Give him the 12th pick and let's make this happen.
Truthfully, I'd say this. I think make him the highest paid coach in the league. He's going to a roster with tons of space that he can basically mold himself.
And a lot of draft assets.
It's not win
just
now.
This year. Yeah.
It wouldn't be win now, but it would definitely give Sean Payton a chance to rebuild another team in his image that would stamp his name.
And you play in a really lousy division, so you have a chance to compete out the gate.
Your biggest division rival with what? Jacksonville?
Right now, it would appear. I mean, the Titans had just... Their injuries were unprecedented this year. I mean, it was just one thing after another, after another, after another. I mean, I think no one's ever fully healthy, but if they're normal amount of NFL healthy, however you want to define that, then they probably win the division.
Yeah.
But they're still not all that good.
No.
So those are the teams that currently have openings. See, I think the Arizona one, Denver's getting a lot of play because they've actually, are set to interview him. But the Cardinals, the GM also being an open spot, I think is pretty intriguing.
Yeah.
Because then you've got Jeff Ireland and Sean Payton. The thing is, they have the third pick in the draft, and it doesn't – I mean, the Cardinals have done some pretty dumb things, but as much as people on the timeline are like, yep, third pick and he's yours, I don't know that they're going to – give away the third overall pick.
No, I don't think they would do that either.
To then sign a guy that's highly, that's up there, man.
Yeah.
That's up there. And they're not going to do anything with the pick until they have a GM and coach. But if they're like, let's bring in Ireland, then you can pretty much, if there's talk of them wanting to interview Jeff Ireland, then the wheels are already in place. They've already made their decision. This is going to be a package deal. Mm-hmm. Sean would love to have a guy in there he's already worked with and knows that he'll still, as the coach, kind of get final say on a lot of the decisions.
Yeah, some free reign.
I think Arizona, even the Kyler Murray thing is interesting. To your point, Nick, but I think that Arizona's in play.
Oh, I don't disagree that Arizona's in play. I just think it's going to be. It's going to be a different situation as far as I just think Kyler Murray's going to have to grow up real quick to play Sean Payton's brand of football because he expects a quarterback that knows how to lead. I mean, it's pretty much all he's ever worked with.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. The Cowboys don't have an opening, but they're a team that's been linked to Payton forever.
Of course.
Payton worked under Parcells. He and Jerry are friends. Mm-hmm. Seems like... In terms of going somewhere where an owner's not going to meddle a lot, I don't know that Dallas is the place to do that.
Yeah.
McCarthy has won a dozen games in back-to-back seasons. Hadn't won a playoff game yet, though. And if Dallas wins Monday night against Tampa, then I think he's all right. But if they have some kind of It's not just if they lose, it's how they lose.
It's how they lose. Yeah, it matters.
But it's almost like, as we say that, Nick, it's almost like, well, if the Cowboys lose, won't it, no matter what happens, be how did they do that? You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, sure, there could be, like, a huge clock management error on McCarthy where everyone's like, oh, my God.
Oh, you're an idiot, yeah.
They have to fire him.
Which would not surprise me.
Despite the fact that he, you know, wins a lot of games.
Yeah.
But even if it's just like, Brady had so much time and everyone was so wide open. Mm. How did you not do this or that? Like, right. I feel like if Dallas loses, no matter what, it's going to be a, how because did you let that happen? That's
because Tampa Bay is not good.
Correct.
They
correct.
But I mean, no offense to anybody personally, but I think a lot of people would have rather see, just give them an extra wild card spot. Don't let Tampa Bay get in this. In his playoff.
All right, what about,
it's not fun to watch.
What about some teams in L.A.? Let's start with the Chargers. Staley's had back-to-back winning seasons. The Chargers are in the playoffs. They had some major injuries. But Staley drives people crazy with being too analytics-driven.
Yeah.
And, dude, what are you doing playing all your guys like a whole game when you have zero to gain? Like, they were locked into the five seed no matter what. Mike Williams was carted off the field. It'd be one thing if you'd been healthy all season. You've been fighting injuries all season. Joey Bosa comes back, then he, I don't know how serious it is, but he leaves with an injury. And then you've got, you know, Dean Spanos. He's an unpredictable owner, but I'm not talking about would Sean Payton want to go to that. I think if they paid him a ton and Justin Herbert was his quarterback, he would. But I think the fact that Spanos is pretty unpredictable tells you, who knows?
That's
out Saturday night and you lose to the Jags or something, no one might even be thinking about it. Then he could be like, yeah, let's do something here. If they're confident they can get Payton, which he let his reps leak out months ago that was the spot that he wanted more than any other. Mm-hmm. So he was, which is not cool, I'm sure, in coaches' circles, but he was vying for a job when there was no opening. You know.
He was vying for a job back when everyone was like, Brandon Staley's done for sure. And now people are like, well, maybe he isn't, and maybe he is. And Spanos is about as predictable as Louisiana weather.
Will Payton... his view of things align with Spanos and the GM, Tom Telesco, and I think if they hire him, they'll just say, yeah, whatever your vision is, that's ours.
Good.
You know what I mean?
I'll be honest, like, that's if I'm Sean Payton, I'm not going anywhere where that's not the case.
The Rams look like they're going to have an opening.
I think so, too.
You know what McVay's doing right now, y'all? He is orchestrating the Sean Payton exit.
That would be insane.
That's what he's doing, though.
Yeah.
I don't mean that Sean Payton's going to take over. I mean, he's doing the same thing Payton did.
Yeah.
I won a Super Bowl. Granted, it was more recent than when Payton did, but I'm looking at our cap situation. I'm looking at our lack of draft assets. I kind of planted the seeds already, you know, the last few years that I might want to get out. Really, what he's going to do is step out for a little while and go do TV for a little bit, get some money.
Do a little bit of an easy job and come back,
say all the right stuff, but ultimately, you know, whoever wherever the Rams are in a year or two, they're still going to be needing draft assets. And so it's like, all right, we'll allow you to go somewhere else, but we want something in return. Kind of, you know what I mean? Like, go on TV so that you're talked about every week, so that you're a sexy name
household,
when it comes to all who... He's doing the exact same thing Payton did and acting like he's really considering not coaching ever again, which we all know is not true. Just like we knew when Sean Payton said he was going to leave. We knew he was coming back to coaching.
Yeah, and for Sean McVay, like, more power to you. Like, you mastered the art of sell it all for 1 year, and you achieved it. You did the thing. As for Sean Payton ending up in L.A. with the Rams, I mean...
They've got some veterans.
They got some vets.
They don't have a first-round pick in 2023.
Their quarterback situation is confusing.
They do have one in 2024.
Because I don't know what's going to go on with Baker and who's their starter.
I mean, Matt Stafford.
Matt Stafford is
30.
But it should tell you something that I forgot.
Matt Stafford is 34. Like, it's not like, which I know is not exactly,
injury-ridden 34.
A spring chicken or anything. Well, I mean, they got to improve their offensive line.
Yeah.
But I think Peyton could look at Stafford and be like, I could work with that.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I could get a couple of years.
Quarterback
out of
whisper?
That.
Yeah, he could get 2 years.
I mean, he's a guy of, you know, he's a veteran. He doesn't have to. I do think there's some appeal with the Rams for Peyton if they wanted to go that route. If you're the Saints, you're not going to get a first rounder this year. All right. And speaking of, what about the Saints?
Yeah, that seems like a pipe dream. When Blaze and I spoke about that at one point while we were hosting the show a few weeks back when that rumor first came out, and we just got a ton of phone calls being like, "Don't buy into it." And
it's never been in play.
It's never been in play. Don't get me wrong. Would I let Sean Payton let? Would I like it if Sean Payton became the coach of the Saints again? Absolutely, I would love it.
If you wanted to magnify his legendary status. If he came back to, quote, save the Saints a second time, save them from his own
mediocrity,
his own exit, which caused some of it, some would believe. No, they don't have a franchise quarterback. They don't have, a bevy of draft assets currently. They don't have, like, all this open cap space. But, with the new TV deal, a lot of teams will eventually. Mm. All those rumors of Peyton and Brady, it's not happening. He was never going to go back to New Orleans.
The only thing Saints have that Peyton likes is a short, fast wide receiver. Because that's what they like. That's what Peyton likes, but
Speaking of fast wide receivers, what about the rumor about Miami?
Oh, interesting.
There's rumors that, that's who they wanted before. Would they move? I think it would be ridiculous to fire McDaniel after one year. They lost a bunch of games at the end of the season, but they lost their quarterback, and that's when the season turned.
The concern for Tua's health is still very, very evident for me. It kind of got pushed to the backseat with all the other craziness that's been going on, especially injury-wise in the NFL. But, I mean, 3 concussions 10 weeks apart is not a small thing, and it's really worth thinking about what his future is going to be. How much longer he's going to last and what he'll be able to do. That's going to make a big difference depending, because it's going to change how Sean Payton looks at that position. And that'll also change how Mike McDaniel gets treated at that position, whether he gets to keep his job or not. Because if Tua just can't go, McDaniel probably gets a little bit more leeway to have some worse seasons before you getting fired, but he might be leaving.
He's done a really good job.
He's done a good job, but I mean, I'm concerned. I don't know why, if he's done such a good job, I don't even know why they're thinking about shopping him.
I
think it's smoke and mirrors.
I think it's just Peyton's reps and it's the media. And hey, remember that what they wanted to do? They wanted to team up Peyton and Brady.
That's
so
they came out at the beginning of the year.
Maybe they might try it. Maybe they might do it. Maybe if Tua leaves, maybe that's the route they go. I think it's just clicks. I don't think it's happening.
There's some who dat out there that genuinely believe it's possible for us to have Sean Peyton and Tom Brady on the team next year.
Yeah, no, that's like, not
no. First off, I don't want it. Second off, no.
No, that was just a.
It's
like when an article's like, remember how there was rumors that this was what they wanted to happen a few years ago if Breeze had retired. Hey, could it happen now? It couldn't. It's not. This, it's a different time. Things have changed.
Remember this outcome that was expected if these 6 things happened that only would have been relevant
several years ago.
Right.
That's just it. Exactly. All right. So where is he going?
I think Sean Payton's going to end up. I want him to end up on the Texans, but I think he's going to end up. I think he's going to end up with the Rams.
The Rams.
I do think McVay leaves. I think they go out and they get him. I just see him wearing that uniform.
All right, I'm going to roll with. I'm just going to say Denver right now.
Denver
1, Arizona 2.
Okay. I would say Arizona 2 as well.
That's where I'm.
I just don't think Denver's going to, I don't know if Denver's going to really draw him that like that.
Well, how does he feel about Russell Wilson? And
yeah.
And did the Walmart owners say, here's a gigantic check?
Right.
I think, and I also think, you know, sometimes when you make a mistake, you have a tendency to overdo doing it the right way or fixing it. Like, I think they're like, boy, we made a lot of mistakes year one. Like, we signed Nathaniel Hackett, and then we did all this stuff for Russell Wilson, and one of these guys we got rid of, the other we can't. How can we rectify this, like, immediately?
Get the one of the better coaches to ever.
What do we need to pay?
Yeah.
He's worked with a short quarterback, and they did great things, and and he's got a, and we've got a good defense, well, and he could fix the offense. Yeah. All we need to do is fix that. And if this and that, here,
I remember the coach.
All right, we have to pay him how much? Doesn't matter. We have Walmart money. Yeah. Like, done.
No, I remember the comps when he was coming into the league of Russell Wilson just being a mobile Drew Brees.
So, yeah, and Russell Wilson has never been as good as Drew Brees.
Of course, but
for
like
the record.
But that was the comp coming in, and like if Sean Payton is familiar with working with a quarterback who shorter in stature, quick decision making, can fit the ball in tight windows, maybe doesn't have the biggest arm, but he can make it happen. If he can fix whatever is going wrong with Russell Wilson right now, maybe the Waltons do go out and give him the bag. I don't know.
Nasty Nick in studio. I'm Scott Prather. It's 103.3 The Goat. Simulcast on 1420. Taking a look at the latest Sean Payton rumors, questions, and more. We're going to take a timeout when we come back. We're going to have Nick pick the wild card team most likely to win a game this weekend. We will take a look at the biggest question marks for each team in the wild card round as well. We'll talk a little college and pro hoops coming up later in the show as well. And just, again, another reason, yet another reason why the national championship should never, ever be held at Sofi Stadium in Los Angeles. We need a permanent residence for that game. We'll talk about that more. Don't go anywhere. It's the Great Scott Show coming at you on a Wednesday. 103.3 The Goat, simulcast on 1420. It's The Goat, greatest sports talk of all time.
Mess with the goat. You'll get the horns, then the butt. Because that's what goats do. 103.3 The Goat.
Welcome back into the Great Scott Show. Coming at you on a Wednesday. Nasty Nick in studio with me. If you want to hit us up, you can call us. 337-269-1077. Final AP poll came out yesterday. Tulane coming in at number 9.
Let's go.
The Wave breaking into the top 10. That is their best finish since 1998 when they went undefeated. And for some reason were not in a BCS game. They had 4 BCS bowls back then. One was the national championship. The other 3 were sort of, you know, the prestigious bowls.
Right.
And they played in the Liberty Bowl, and I don't remember who they beat, but maybe BYU. I mean, they just destroyed them. And that was Tommy Bowden, and they were really good. And then they, you know, went back to kind of being Tulane for a while. But this season for TCU is kind of the ultimate turnaround. And I know no one's thinking about that now because of the beating that they took on Monday night.
Bad for that.
But considering that they were unranked in 5-7 last year and played for the Natty, is that's kind of, but right behind them, I mean, Tulane had 2 wins last year. And then they end up being that group of five team that's in the Cotton Bowl and not just in it, but win it in dramatic fashion. So
what, that might have been my favorite bowl all season.
Sure, yeah. No, that it was the most entertaining bowl, I think, by a mile.
Yeah.
But Georgia, TCU, Michigan, Ohio State, Alabama, Tennessee, Penn State, Washington, Tulane, Utah, Florida State, USC, Clemson, Kansas State, Oregon, LSU at 16, Oregon State, Notre Dame, that's your top 18 teams there.
Oh, 18, okay. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, yeah, I definitely think who ended up at 2 was it? The final eight people?
TCU. They had to, yeah.
Right. Oh, right,
Did you see who finished 19th? I stopped at 18. Did you see who finished 19th?
No, I did not.
Troy.
Wow. Good.
Troy.
Good.
Troy. So your highest ranked group of five was Tulane. Your next highest ranked group of five was a team from the Sun Belt. And I think, you know, the American Athletic and the Sun Belt, they're kind of looked at as one and then two as far as group of five goes. Mm. But yeah, those were Troy at 19 in the AP, and I think 20 in the coaches. Mm. Mississippi State 20, UCLA 21, Pitt 22, South Carolina 23. Fresno State 24, there's your third group of five. And then Texas just gets into the top 25.
Man, I can't wait for that.
Final AP poll. Yeah, oh, look out for the Longhorns.
Look out for Texas, here we go.
It's Texas, going to disappoint everyone again.
Yeah.
Maybe they'll actually have a draft pick this year.
Yeah. I mean, look, I could think of about, I can think of three colleges in Texas that are better than Texas at football. One of them we played in a bowl game. One of them Louisiana played in a bowl game this year.
So you That's would awesome. Say Houston is better than Texas?
I think so right now. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. I mean, certainly TCU is.
Yeah. TCU certainly. Texas
A&M. A&M is not better than Texas. A&M is terrible.
They're not good.
No. Texas, look, I can't believe I'm defending Texas.
I can't believe you're defending
Texas. It was not great. And certainly in terms of expectations.
They did have injury.
No, they finished the top 25. Texas A&M was terrible.
Texas A&M was bad.
Just terrible. Now, you know, I don't know. If you want to start saying TCU, you want to say Houston, you want to say, you know, Texas Tech, probably not. No, I mean, the reality is Texas wasn't the best team in Texas, again. I remember the last time they were in a season. It's been a while, but college football officially in the books. You go to SoFi Stadium where they charge you a kidney to park, okay? You're out in Inglewood. Which, I, for the record, I like L.A., but it's a terrible college sports town.
Yeah.
It's not a great sports town in general. They do have an affinity for the Lakers and the Dodgers. So I will give them that. Although, having been to a New Orleans Hornets game at the Staples Center at the time against the Lakers, I can tell you that it's in the upper bowl, they're like, you know, more of your everyday folk residents that are into it. The lower bowl is just a bunch of rich people that show up late and leave early. Like it's
right.
As much as they're the glamour team, it's not like the lower bowl is on a normal game day is like this. Now Dodger games, there's not a lot of glitz and glam. It's like
baseball.
Yeah, but I mean, it's just from an LA standpoint. Like the Lakers have the element of like I want to be seen here.
Right.
The Dodgers, it's like all just like
go watch
Dodgers.
A baseball game.
Let's go and you'll get folks. So, but as a whole, aside from that, like it's just a terrible sports town.
Yeah. No, it's not good.
It's a terrible sports town. And you have a national championship there where you don't allow tailgating, where you charge out the wazoo for parking. And then if you want a beer, the cheap beer, like the cheaper option of the beer,
$17. $17. I knew you were going to say something
for a little,
crazy.
A little 12-ounce cup of beer, of Pacifico or Negro Modelo. $17.
Oh,
and then the, I don't know, maybe like Heineken or something is like $19.
Oh my God.
That's how much a one beer costs you when you're not allowed to tailgate. Strict no tailgating policy.
So what? I mean,
what an awful place to have. I can't even imagine like what the food must have cost.
Oh God.
I get that everything is marked up. I get it. I spent a lot of money on some beer at a Pelicans game last Friday. I wasn't spending $17 a beer, and I was drinking some pretty good beer, by the way. But like, I mean, we went to a bar. We got some Bloody Marys. They were strong. They were spicy. Yeah. We spent a little money, but I was like, yeah, this is more than if you got it at a bar outside the arena. But at the same time, you know, if we were in L.A., this probably would have cost us like $100.
Yeah, right. Like, it's just that I guess.
Like, there's markup, and then there's like, bro, $17 for a 12-ounce cup of like Pacifico.
Who pays for that?
A national championship has become, in some ways, certainly not as big as the Super Bowl, but in regards to ticket sales and attendees, it's a corporate event. Like, from that standpoint, if you want to make the national championship game, and that's what, back when the national championship was held at a bowl game.
Right.
Like, back before the BCS added a fifth game, and then they called it the national championship. Before, it was like, well, the Rose Bowl is going to be the national championship this year. Or it's the Sugar, or the Fiesta, or the Orange. Yeah. You still had that element of like the bowl history, the pageantry, the trophy from that specific bowl.
Yeah, it felt bowl. Like a part of the...
It did, and it felt like college. And then when you added the fifth game, when you started at first still rotating it with the games that were already there, it's like, okay, we're going to have the Sugar Bowl, and then in a week and a half, we're going to have the national championship game right here too.
Right.
It would take a little bit away from the Sugar Bowl that year, if that makes sense. Like, it start, and then once you had the college football playoff, not just having it at different venues on a rotating basis, it became a lot more corporate. Mm-hmm. So not as many ticket sales for the college fan. For the ones that are, you got to have money or connections to even get in. And then when you have it at a place like LA, you know, when Clemson routed Alabama, I don't know, four or five years ago, that was in Santa Clara, which was just really difficult to get to. It's like, Clemson and Bama and Santa Clara. I don't know.
Yay.
Had it been at the Rose Bowl, now that's Pasadena, that's L.A., but
it's the Rose Bowl.
There's like, a pageantry to it, right? Yeah. There's an element to that that still feels very college football.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I don't know how much, you know, a beer is in the old Rose Bowl in Pasadena. It's probably not $17. You don't have the national championship in L.A.
No.
You can have the Rose Bowl in Pasadena. That's fine. Don't have the national championship in L.A. Don't do that. Like, don't. Don't do that ever again. It needs to just be in New Orleans every year.
I was about to say that exact same thing.
Every year.
The Superdome, I think, is the optimal location for that game. I don't know what it is about it, but something about the way that the game looks underneath the lights in the Superdome, it just elevates college teams to looking just completely different.
Under the lights when it's dark outside at your house, when you're watching it on TV.
Exactly.
It does. But on top of that, the reason so many media members enjoy it isn't because, oh, they get to go to Pato's or whatever touristy spot they can go get drunk. Like, that's fine. The reason they like it is because it's convenient. You can walk from the dome to the quarter to the CBD to, you don't have to. I've been to, you know, what I guess it's called Hard Rock Stadium now in Miami. Miami's great. All right. Yeah. Miami's great, but that stadium is not near anything.
No, it's not.
You got to drive far, and then you're just in a giant parking lot, which is cool, I guess, if you want to tailgate, if they allow it for a little while. But, like, as far as leaving the game and getting in and out and all that, in Arizona, it's not, like, they have some little shops next to it, but it's not like this part of the city. It's like, let's just have some little, you know, cookie cutter, stereotypical national brand shop restaurant next to the venue. It's not the same feel as, dude, we just exited this game. We're in this culture.
We're in the city, you leave Hard Rock Stadium. Oh, there's a Chili's 5 minutes away. Yay. You walk out of the Superdome, you can get to world-class restaurants in 5 minutes of walking.
Right. Or you know, a dive bar. Like, you kind
either
of have
way,
your
yeah,
options.
Either direction you want to go.
And you can get to your hotel easily.
Oh, of course.
You know, in Miami, you don't have that. In Arizona, you don't
the
have
infrastructure
that.
Infrastructure is fantastic.
In Pasadena,
in
you don't have that. Just looking at, like, the old four traditional spots when it was rotating between those four bowls, you know, I mean, you could do it in Atlanta, but, like, Atlanta's not as great a city to.
No, you know, well, it's not.
You know, it's just not. And then when you get out, like, a lot of these places, like, look, AT&T Stadium, I haven't been. But I do know Jerry's built, like, a little town around it of,
yeah,
like,
Jerry
and
World.
Stuff.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it kind of is.
It's called Jerry World for
a
reason.
It's not even just the venue. It's everything around
it. The whole thing,
Like, it would be like if you went to, you know, if every time Orlando hosted, it was, like, in the middle of Disney World. It's like, well, I know where this money's going to.
I can't imagine a Dallas Cowboys-themed theme park. Ugh.
That's essentially what it is.
But I don't,
it's just Jerry's.
Less of a reason.
It's not really even Cowboys-themed. It is. It very much is. But it's more
Jerry-themed.
Yeah. It wouldn't surprise me if there's, like, a plastic surgeon. Facelift right here. Let's do it. Next to Jerry's helicopter pad.
Buy your Jerry Jones Squishmallow now.
My goodness. Well, Jerry. I'm not just saying it because we're in Louisiana. Just put it in New Orleans every year.
No, I mean, come
put
on.
Put the natty there. Now,
best national championships have all been in New Orleans.
You could say it would hurt the Sugar Bowl a little bit, but all of those bowls have been hurt by the current setup. They just have.
Yeah.
Like, who remembers the Sugar Bowl this year?
It was Alabama and Kent State.
Did you say Kent State?
Kansas State. See? Do you get my point?
Kent State. Bama won the Sugar Bowl. But, like, it's very forgettable, whereas back in the old – my point is the idea of, well, if you do that, it could water down. Well, no. What you need is your biggest game – that crowns a champion to not be watered down. And that's what
it needs to be on the
it's been
stage.
Watered down with just corporate.
Yeah.
That's what it's been watered
down. SoFi Stadium isn't – even Rams fans don't want to go to SoFi Stadium.
There's no such thing.
Yeah.
There's no such thing as Rams
Chargers
fans.
Don't want to go
there's
to SoFi
no
Stadium.
Thing. There's no it's such thing.
You're making my point.
There's no such
like,
thing.
Like, it's – I don't – I when I saw it was at SoFi, I was like, why? What has SoFi Stadium done to earn it? I don't know. And then all the, like, there was no walls. There's a roof, but no walls. So all the rain's coming in the side. People are slipping, getting
very
stretchered out.
Very weird that it's not completely. I mean, it's kind of a gaffe on their
part. I don't understand,
man. You shouldn't have, like, lightning delays when you're at SoFi Stadium. That's happened before.
It's a covered dome, but you can't. I don't know.
Jay emails. He says, they need to stop calling it the national championship game because it isn't broadcast on national TV. Change it to the cable championship game. The streaming championship game.
That's
where it's going.
Don't speak that into existence
too much. I didn't watch much of it, I'll be honest.
Yeah, I watched...
I watched the Pelicans and would occasionally be like, what's the score now?
Yeah, how bad has this gotten? And it sucks, too. I'll come right out and say it. I'm a big Max Duggan supporter. I was very, like, excited for Max Duggan, and I thought he was doing really good stuff. I still think he's a really good quarterback, but man, oh man, Georgia.
I wonder if Ohio State had won, what the score would have been.
Oh.
Would have been a different game. I mean, TCU beat Michigan.
I'll say this: Georgia still puts up 65 points, but Ohio State puts up more.
No. I'm talking about if Ohio State had beat Georgia because they almost did.
Right.
If Ohio State had played TCU.
Wow. I don't know. This is definitely SEC bias coming into play, but I think it's a heck of a lot closer. I mean, I think that's a close game. 14 points or less. Which is a close game considering TCU was 8-point underdogs to Michigan before they came in and beat them. And it took Michigan throwing two pick sixes and like a fumble
I'm
or
just
something.
Saying, though. It's just, you know.
Yes.
TCU, it feels like it's
TCU, Ohio State would have been a better national championship.
The problem is, like, the lasting image is, like, the last thing you saw.
Yeah. Well, because the other thing that concerns me about it is that I don't think the score would have been too much different had Michigan been in instead of TCU. I still think Georgia puts up 65 on them.
I think there's also something about the long break between games that,
mm-hmm.
teams get it. They're able to prepare. I don't know. We could overanalyze. I mean, the reality is Georgia did beat Ohio
Georgia's
State.
Just fantastic.
And we beat them down.
They're just a fantastic football team. They are crazy. The amount of talent they have is just nuts.
All right. So the Raging Cajuns. We're on college football. Let's shift gears to the Cajuns for a second. They were supposed to have New Mexico State on their schedule next year, and something happened that fell through. So, you know, given the game against New Mexico State is likely going to be canceled, there's some FBS teams that have an opening. SMU, San Diego State University, Ohio, Miami, Baylor. Now, the Cajuns have an FCS game on their schedule already. You don't want two because you can't count both wins toward bowl eligibility. San Diego State and Ohio, they both already have an FCS game on their schedule as well. I don't know, man. You can't go another FCS game.
I'm trying to think. Was Ohio the team that the Cajuns played in the Mobile Bowl? What was it called?
The Lending Tree Bowl.
Lending Tree Bowl. Was it Ohio or was it Miami of Ohio?
It was Miami of Ohio.
Okay.
It was Miami of
Ohio. I knew it was one of the two. I just couldn't remember which one.
Now, UL did play Ohio years back when I'm thinking of Kent State. But anyway,
thinking of Kent State too. Both of us got Kent State on the brain.
Back when Julian Edelman was there.
Yeah.
I think you've got. I mean, you know, UL played Ohio recently.
Yeah.
They beat them by a ton in the game. So they've played Ohio more recently. So I think my point is, I think you start looking at San Diego State as figure out what you can do there.
Yeah, it's a good look.
You know,
it's a good non-conference game.
I would try to figure it out, but it's, we'll see. Maybe this New Mexico thing does happen. It's weird because they list them on the schedule that the Cajuns release, but then New Mexico State's not. I'll be honest, I haven't looked as deeply into it as, you know, some of the hardcore fans have, but. Let's just say, for sake of this discussion, it does happen. I think San Diego State would make some sense.
Yeah, they would. I agree. What I'm wondering,
and it's not, by the way, New Mexico State isn't on their website schedule. It was on like a Twitter thing that they dropped like last week. So
right,
something happened.
So interesting. So San Diego State, you think Miami would be one of those options too, or no?
Probably not, like a home and home or something.
Not for a home and home. I couldn't imagine that. So they have to fill out the rest of the whole.
I think you want a home game because you got two road games, non-conference at Minnesota and against UAB. You have Northwestern
at
State
Minnesota?
At home.
Minnesota,
September 30th. Yeah, so
wow.
you've got a spot there where you just, I don't know, you want to.
Yeah, you want to. Yeah. Huh.
Mexico State.
In that case, I could definitely see San Diego.
I don't know. I don't know all the logistics. That's something I'm gonna make a couple phone calls. Try to see if I can gather any information. I'm sure that stuff's happening behind the scenes. Just which direction is the wind blowing? Mm. You know, I guess we'll find out soon enough. But that's a little aspect of UL football that fans are paying attention to right now.
Of course,
coming up in the 8 o'clock hour, Wild Card Weekend. Super Wild Card Weekend,
super
as they
wild
call
card
it.
Weekend. Oh man,
you put the word "super."
So I was about to say that exact thing.
I was like, should I just change it to the Super Scott Show?
Ooh,
I don't know. I mean,
Super Great Scott Show.
Double. I mean, the Great Scott Show. It's kind of a corny title to begin with, but like, if you had Super, I don't know. Maybe it
Stack Overflows to being.
I think
corny.
I just need to have a specific, just one episode. Where we just blow it out, like go all out, and just that specific episode,
that
the
super
great
Scott show. Yeah,
and then
you just have like three guests on the whole show.
I just imagine you add Super. What was it? What was the? I'm not. I'll be honest. I mean, I watched the U.S. national team. Other than that, I don't watch a lot of soccer.
Me neither.
But there was some story a year ago where some of the richer teams were trying to veer off. Some of the richer owners in some of the leagues overseas were trying to veer off and start their own league. And they were going to call it the Super League or something. And it ended up not working. I guess there was enough backlash from fans and other. Anyway. But it was just like the idea that they were going to call it the Super
League. Yeah.
I was like, the NFL, all the owners are like, tell you what, we can get more money by just adding two more playoff games. One team in each conference will make it happen. That way we can have six games, more TV money. All right, yeah, everybody, all in favor, say aye. Aye. All right, let's prove it with the union. Let's make this happen. And then I just imagine one owner's like, wait. Only if we call it the Super Wild Card Weekend.
That,
like, what if it wasn't called the Super Bowl? What if it was just called the NFL Final?
Yeah, NFL Championship.
No.
It wouldn't matter.
Don't say that. Don't say it wouldn't matter. I think it would matter.
It would matter.
But there's nothing like the Super Bowl.
It's the Super Bowl.
Like, it's known everywhere. It's an unofficial American holiday. It's all this stuff. It's like Super Bowl Sunday, NFL Championship Sunday.
Yeah.
Championship Sunday is the conference championship games. That's what they call it.
You
can't call it the NFL Lombardi. Nothing against Lombardi. He's got the trophy. Good for him.
Good.
It's the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
You put Super in front of it, bro.
It's the only bowl game the NFL plays.
I was talking about when I was a kid, there was the Superstore. The Superstore was located where the Grand 16 is.
Okay.
Was
it just the Superstore? It wasn't like a brand?
No, I think the Superstore was, I'm going to have to Google. I think the Superstore was like a thing.
Oh, okay.
It was like a chain, but there was something about it, and it might have been, I'm going to have to Google it. I was about to say it might have been like Costco-esque, but I don't know that it was. I just remember you had to like put a quarter in the, you had to put a quarter in like the, some kind of chain so that you could get a cart, which I think they do at like Aldi or something. I don't know. It was just this giant.
Oh, yeah, you got to buy your own bags at all.
It was this giant store. And now, I mean, anytime I try to Google it, it just brings up the TV series, show, apparently. Yeah. So it was a thing. It was like this yellow and black colors.
Interesting.
And I don't even remember if it was any good. It was just the idea as a kid, you were like, it's called the Superstore.
Yeah, of course. It's got to be cool.
I got to go in there. They must have everything.
Our Walmart was called the Walmart Superstore.
Super Center or Superstore?
It was a Superstore. Walmart Superstore. Right. That was what it was called.
Well,
and I mean, that mattered, right?
It's not just any Walmart.
It's not just, it's a Superstore.
Just put Super in front of it.
Or like the Super Target. You ever been to Super Target?
Aren't they now just Targets?
They're not just called Targets.
Now they're.
So would that mean?
The real Superstore, it was a grocery store. This was written on one of our station websites like 6 years ago.
Jeez.
Real Superstore opened in the early 80s, closed in the mid 90s. It became Schwegman Supermarket very shortly and then closed. Gosh, I'm reading this article written by Jobo, who used to work here.
Oh, yeah.
Says, one thing many people, especially kids back then, remember is that in order to get a shopping cart, you had to put in a quarter. It would release the cart. That's what I remembered. And you could do your shopping. When it was time to leave, you would hook your shopping cart back up to the string of other carts and get your quarter back.
Oh, it gives you your
quarter. Besides the quarter-tricking carts, these are the words of Jobo, Josh Belanger. One memory I have is that my mom and I went shopping there one time. She spent an extended amount of time looking for a king cake that still had its frosting intact on top of the cake. After finding the one that still had all of its frosting, we got to the register, and the person checking us out, only known as Henry to my little mind, went and turned the cake over in order to scan it. Needless to say, my mama wasn't happy. The store was owned by the National Tea Company. When they went bankrupt around 1994, the real Superstore was a superstore no longer. In fact, it wasn't even a store anymore. So, yeah, real Superstore, that's an 80s and 90s thing.
There you go.
But look, this is what it looked like. I mean, it looked huge from the outside. That was on Johnson Street. Look at that
photo.
Oh, my
gosh. That looks like, wow.
And they had all the flags on top of it.
It's so broad.
Yeah, it was. It has to be if you're going to be called the Superstore.
Yeah, I mean, it's huge.
All right, I've spent too much time on the word super.
No, I feel like we spent the correct amount of time.
I apologize.
The word super.
We're going to take a timeout. 8 o'clock hour coming up. The question mark for each NFL team in the wild card round. We'll dig into that. And Which wildcard team is going to win this weekend?
I know my answer.
All right. Don't go anywhere. The Great Scott Show continues after this.
It's a good thing goats have four stomachs. Otherwise, there's no way we could swallow some of these takes.
Hey, goat, what's going on out there?
103.3 The Goat, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Great Scott!
The Great Scott Show.
And as they head into the final furlong, all of the other radio stations and radio hosts are left in the wake of a keen turn of speed by the Great Scott Show, the champion.
With Scott Prather.
Steal the show.
Welcome into the Great Scott Show. Coming at you on a Wednesday, Scott Prather, Nick Sheremy. Got a couple emails. Got a couple super emails.
Super emails.
Derek says,
super listeners.
Scott, I remember the Superstore. It felt like something that was so good on the outside. When you got on the inside, it was kind of dark and cold. I guess so.
Oh, that's, you know what that is. That's super disappointing.
That's super disappointing. I think it was like the Real Superstore. I don't know. When you're a kid, it's like maybe it was the flags on top. Like they used to have this toy store when I was a kid. It wasn't in Lafayette, but they had it in like parts of New Orleans. It was called the Children's Palace. The inside, I mean, you would get all amped up, but then when you get in, you just try to buy like a Nintendo game or something. And it was probably like Toys R Us. But the outside, like the flags, it was like... There's something good in there. And so when you're like six or seven and you see these flags atop this giant building and the word super, you're like,
it's got to be interesting. I got to see what's inside.
Jay emails, he said and I think I remember this. He said some workers in the Superstore wore skates while they worked in the store.
Oh, whoa, like a Sonic?
Yeah. Skate around. They probably needed it, man. Imagine the amount of steps they got.
That's huge.
Sprawling
huge
around
space,
that place.
So got to be.
Shout out to the Real Superstore, has been closed for nearly 30 years.
When I worked at a certain sporting goods store, I would clock 20,000 steps a day, and I just worked in the shoe section. I couldn't imagine.
On your feet, man. On your feet. All right, thanks for the super emails, guys. Appreciate that. NFL Wild Card Weekend.
Super Wild Card Weekend.
Super Wild Card Weekend. Literally, that's what they call it. So we gotta be real here. Super Wild Card Weekend. Let's talk about it. First, let's go through the question mark facing each team. I think let's do this alphabetically. I think starting with Baltimore, to me, it's pretty easy. Does Lamar play or does he not?
Yeah.
If he plays, you have a chance on any day to beat any team.
Of course.
If he doesn't, you're going to lose to Cincinnati.
Oh, absolutely.
And the other added layer to this is there's some people that feel like, oh, man, this injury, it's hurting his contract. I'm like, no. It's helping it quite a bit.
Yeah.
They go from really good to having trouble winning a game.
Yep.
Pay the man.
Yeah, it's that simple.
They've offered to pay the man. They just don't want to do the guarantee thing. But the thing is, they can't let him get out on the open market because then someone else will. Lamar's smart. And for as much as he's been criticized for not having an agent, I feel like
he's a smart guy.
I feel like he's played this thing pretty good.
Yeah.
I feel like he's played it pretty good. All right, what about the Bills? What is their biggest question marks?
Man, I would say it's their. Say it's their run game still, and I would also say they're probably their middle level of their defense.
I mean, look, I think
not saying that those are literally questions, like they're that bad, but that's the only weaknesses I see this team have.
I think it's the interceptions.
Yeah,
Josh Allen throws a lot of interceptions. Now he is awesome. And he seems like a more likable guy than Brett Favre was. But I remember back in the day, everyone loved Favre. And I'm like, the guy's not
jerk.
Cool.
Yeah.
He's not, but no one wanted to hear it. And now everyone's like, yeah, maybe he's pretty. He's kind of a lousy guy. But he runs a lot more than Favre did. I just mean in terms of, like, risk-taking.
Oh, he takes
because
risk.
He's got such a strong arm that sometimes he's like, you know what? I got it. I'm going to let it rip. And it's like... Yeah. What are you doing? Like, you're right there. You're in the red zone.
Yeah.
That's to me. Now, you don't want to tame the dog too much because
you don't want him to lose what makes him special.
Right, right. And that's why I feel like it's always, to me, it's going to be the question mark for them. If they're in a close game, is the interception coming? Or is Allen going to be like, you know what? I can take risks, but I need to. Need to have a risk manager.
Yeah,
I need to have risk management manager in my mind. Like, okay, this is too risky.
And he does the same thing on the ground too, because he tries to jump over people and shoulder check people.
But
he's got the physical acumen to do it. But
it is what
it's
it
not
is.
Gonna last forever, just, man.
It's part of what makes him awesome.
He's awesome, dude. He's so fun to watch.
And I think the fact that you know if they get to the AFC title game and if the Chiefs aren't upset that game's on a neutral field.
Yeah.
And had they, you know, won the Monday night game that ended up being canceled, that wouldn't be the case. But, you know, as a neutral field, an AFC neutral field would be really interesting.
That would be crazy.
It's probably going to happen.
I would say so. It
it's
looks
probably
like going to happen.
You know, we'll see. All right, Cincinnati. That's their O-line. It's got to be, right?
Yeah. It's can Joe Burrow stay clean?
They invested in it, and now it's beat up going in, and it's kind of like, oh, here we go again.
We're back to square one.
Here we go again. Let's see if Burrow could just take a beating but somehow figure it out.
If Joe Burrow has another game where he takes 8 sacks and wins a playoff game, I'm going to – like, at that point, you just have to admit he might be one of the
– It might happen.
Yeah.
It might happen.
He might be one of the best young quarterbacks alive right now.
Well, he is.
But he might be better than – some of these other guys who have protection.
If he gets, if he makes another run to the Super Bowl, then it's undeniable.
Yeah.
The Cowboys, biggest question mark.
This is where I was going to say interceptions. Dak Prescott makes bad decisions with the ball. He does. He just makes bad decisions with the ball in his hand.
I'm just going to say Mike McCarthy. I mean, it's,
yeah, sure.
Mike McCarthy in a pressure situation where time is of the essence on the clock. I mean. Do you trust him?
Do I trust Mike McCarthy?
In those moments?
No.
The thing is, he's not a terrible. I mean, he's won a Super Bowl. He's won a lot of games, but
he's one of the weirdest coaches to think about because he's won so many games, but you always see him as a liability.
Oh, he's nervous. That's right. You're right. Jacksonville.
I said it already for the Bills. I'm going to say it again here. Travis Etienne in the run game, because Trevor Lawrence has stepped up greatly, and he's really coming into his own. You're starting to see why he got picked first and why he's supposed to be the next guy up in the league. But he can't do it all himself. He's still not there yet, and he doesn't have a lot of the weapons that he would need to be able to do it himself. So that run game is going to have to work against the Chargers.
Yeah, I think for Jacksonville, the house money aspect of being there.
Mm.
When you're the house money gets used in a positive, it's usually a positive metaphor when you're talking about sports.
You're playing with the house's money, yeah.
Yeah, like TCU house money.
Mm-hmm.
No one thought they'd be here. When it comes to Jacksonville, does house money for some teams be we're just really happy to be here?
Yeah,
and you know I know last year for Cincinnati that wasn't the case, and some of that comes from Joe Burrow. I mean, I love this past week when. After the game on Sunday, one of the reporters were like, "Well, I mean, how long do you think this championship window can actually be?" He's like, "As long as I'm the quarterback."
That's That's like the best answer.
But that's
ever.
How every quarterback should how, answer like, yeah, the question.
Absolutely.
But like, you know, he's like dead serious.
Oh yeah.
You know, he's like,
look,
it's like, as long as I'm here,
Burrow
it's
is a special guy because he has the type of competitive fire that you only see a few times in a lifetime.
You know, so for Jacksonville as a whole, are they going to Saturday night at home?
Yeah.
Chargers, you know, a lot of pats on the back. You did it. You were 2-6.
Yeah, like in Duval, people are going to be leather jacketed up.
Is house money a good thing or a bad thing?
I don't know. I think.
All right. What about the team they're playing? We'll skip over the Chiefs briefly, so I'm not going alphabetically here. But sure. Since we're on the Jags, what about the Chargers?
I mean,
it's the Chargers.
It's the Chargers.
So they
yeah.
find ways to lose games.
I was
going to
say they just lose games. That's just what they do. I would say at the end of the day, it comes down to one, Mike Williams. How is he doing? What's he going to look like? And is Brandon Staley going to mess this
up? He's the question mark.
Yeah.
Because there is, I feel like there's a fine line between analytics and. Just
knowing ball,
like right, feel of the game.
Yes,
you know, analytics. I think any coach that doesn't use it at all is stubborn and not helping themselves.
Of course,
but I think anyone that only uses it is negating the feel of the game.
Yeah,
and I've said that. I used to talk to Billy Napier about it when he would come on because he would go for it on fourth a lot and they would make it And I was like, how much is that analytical driven versus feel of the game? He's like, it has to be both. Like, if you don't, if you're ignoring one or the other, like, you can't simulate feel of the game, everything that's unfolded up to that point on a sheet of paper or a computer with percentages. Like, you don't, the percentages don't take into account what just happened. The four plays before, five plays before.
How scrappy the guys are.
Right. How you're, you know, it can, it what it does is it looks at time and score.
Yep.
Well, what about injuries? What about crowd? What about environment? What about, man, if we don't get this first, if we mess up on fourth down, our defense is going to be out there again, and this just happened, and that just happened. So that's the problem with Staley, and I think that's the Chargers' biggest question mark going. What about Kansas City?
I feel that the defense is the only question I could possibly have for the Chiefs because that's been their weak point for the last however long they've been around and relevant. Patrick Mahomes is going to score points, but it's can they stop whoever else from scoring points? I mean,
yeah, I think that's it's weird. Kansas City's weird to me. Like, they should have more than one Super Bowl because it feels like they've just been there constantly. Mahomes has been the best player in the world. They're always good. But then you see them in games, Nick, where it's like, how did they not put that team away? Like, they get.
That's what I'm saying.
They get. You mentioned the defense.
They get funny.
They get too cute.
Yeah.
On offense, they get too cute whenever it's like. You don't need. You're up three touchdowns. Like, they struggled to put the Texans away 2 weeks ago.
The reason I didn't mention that is that because in the playoffs, I always find maybe not necessarily that they get less funny and less silly, but that the teams are playing are better, and so they don't have the chance to relax.
I guess. But you remember the loss to Cincinnati last year? Like, all they had to do was score. Like, they had the ball inside the one at the end of the half, then. And they're still winning, and you're like, well, they're going to get like a good bit of points in the second half, and then their offense just couldn't.
Shut down. Yeah,
it was like it was really weird. And Cincinnati ended up going to the Super Bowl, and there was so much talk of Kansas City in the week before in 12 seconds and this Buffalo thriller, and then it was like the next week, it's like, guys, you still have two more games.
Yeah,
to win.
You're not done yet.
It's really weird. They're games where I just feel like they should. I mean, it's a testament to how good they are. They should have blown out teams a lot more this season than they actually did.
Yeah.
You know, games where it's like, you were up big on that team. How did you let them get back?
Yeah, like that ring around the rosy junk they did this past week, that works in week 18. That does not work
against
the
Raiders. Against the Raiders.
Yeah. That doesn't work in the playoffs.
Yeah. Maybe it does in the first half, but then in the second half it doesn't, and it's like,
oh, yeah,
you were up by a lot. What are you doing?
What are you doing?
You don't have to do this again. Ring around the rosy stuff. All right, let's keep going. Question marks for, all right, the Dolphins.
Man, who's playing quarterback? and
that's it. That's it.
Like, there's nothing else for it.
If Tua isn't playing, I mean, even if he was, it'd be tough to win at Buffalo. And I know they played him tough there in the cold, but a lot of concussions for Tua. This team finally won a game after losing, I think, five in a row.
That's not great.
Yeah, you struggle to put away the Jets. You just, I would. There is a house money aspect to Miami. There, like we're. It's not really house money because I think when they're 8-3, everyone expected them to be there. It's more of like a relief. Like, I'm just glad we got in. Like, I'm glad the collapse. I'm glad Buffalo beat New England. We're just glad to be here.
We managed the crisis to a point where we were still able to get to the playoffs.
Like, if Tua plays, there'll be plenty of debate of whether he should or shouldn't. And I'm not there. I'm not a doctor. I'm not in it. All I know, I'm not a neurologist. I just know if he does play, they're a totally different team.
Yeah.
And then it could be a game.
Yeah, I agree.
Minnesota. Oh, they're the most disrespected team in the postseason. Well, they kind of gave plenty of us reason to be.
Look at the point differential. Primetime Kirk Cousins. Who shows up?
Well, the game's in the afternoon. It's not prime time, but it is.
The only game on television.
It isn't at noon. It's the only game on television.
It might as well be prime time. It's which Kirk Cousins will show up, and they've just been doing, the Vikings have been doing the thing where they just play at the same level as their competition every game.
The fact that they're 13-4
just blows
and had a negative point differential this season is astounding.
By a lot.
The Saints were -15 this year. The Vikings were -3. Like, that's not that. That's a 12-point difference.
Yeah.
Saints were 7-10. The Vikings were 13-4.
Yeah. After the Packers game, the Vikings had like a -12 or 14.
It's the Vikings. Just the question mark is, can they not get blown out?
Yeah.
Because if they don't, they're going to win.
Yeah.
They've won 11-0 in one score games this year. And yes, that's an NFL record. And yes, no team that's won 13 games have been negative. Like, they have set all kinds of good and bad records this year. And that, to me, is like, it's
unpredictable.
Yeah. It's like you give your kid cereal and you put the milk all the way to the top and you're like, don't spill it all. And either they're going to listen and it's going to be a perfect bowl, or the milk's going to be everywhere. Like, right. The Vikings are just messy. And then they get the Giants, who, by the way, were also negative in point differential. So it's kind of like, I'm surprised. I don't know. I'd like to know what the pecking order was as far as when networks got to pick what game they wanted. Because I can't imagine, even with the New York market, I can't imagine Fox said, this is the Sunday afternoon slot. This is the game we want. Like, how did ESPN get Dallas-Tampa? I mean, that's the one that Fox wanted.
Yeah.
How did that become the... Like, I would have bet money beforehand, and I would have lost it all, that Jacksonville-LA would be the afternoon game on Saturday. Seattle-San Francisco probably would have been the night one, because you can't put it at noon. You don't want to put it on Sunday night. Or... You know, if anything, that might either Seattle, San Francisco, or Minnesota. If you had told me Minnesota Giants or Seattle, San Francisco, you could take one of those two to be the Monday night game, or you could have the field. I would have taken that every time, not the field, every time.
Yeah.
Like, but whatever. It is what it is.
Tom
ESPN,
Brady.
Monday Night Football's thrilled.
Yeah.
They get Cowboys, who are always a draw,
and Tom Brady
on a Monday night in a playoff game. Anyway. I digress. Giants. Tell me about the Giants. What's their question mark? I don't need to add to the Vikings. You said everything that needed to be said.
The Giants are just they're a weird, scrappy team, and they win weird, ugly games. If they can make the game ugly, they can win. But on the other hand, the Vikings win one score games.
Including one against the Giants just a few weeks ago.
Correct. But I think the Giants are a good enough team to beat the Vikings. They've shown they can do that. I think if they get out to a two score lead and it's a weird point spread, I think they can win the game.
They never
like
get out to
like
two
an
score
11
leads,
point
though.
Lead.
But like, they never do that. Like, they're, it's weird in that,
or they play from behind the whole game.
Their way of winning is similar to the Vikings.
Yeah, that's why it's so weird. It's hard for me to
and
like.
So
judge.
Because Minnesota's probably gonna win this game. I think
probably.
So. And then, you know, what they do the next week, they'll go to maybe probably San Francisco and, you know,
get
get
stopped.
Kirk Cousins will, you know, look bad and they'll lose by three scores. And it was going to be like, oh my God, it was the Vikings.
I will put my hand up and say, without spoiling too much, I have a different opinion on this game.
All right. You think the Giants win?
I do.
I think whoever wins loses the next week.
I agree with that. Because San Francisco is a juggernaut.
Eagles.
How's Jalen Hurts? He's a big question mark right now. And
not playing their best ball going into the postseason.
Yeah, correct. So they've kind of fallen off the horse a little bit in terms of this like unbeatable look that they were giving for the early part of the season. They finished really weakly. Finished kind of whimpering.
Saints took it to them, but
that was Gardner Minshew.
No Jalen Hurts, but he looked hurt, and they didn't look great against the Giants team that did what Staley should have done, which is let's rest a bunch of guys since we're locked into this seed.
And their defense wasn't great against the anemic Saints offense either. And that defense was playing pretty hard.
Which was weird, considering how dominant their D-line is and the Saints O-line was all beat up. It was weird. I think you've got to be a little concerned. Speaking of the Saints, in 09, they lost three straight games going into the playoffs. One of them they weren't trying to win, but two of them they were, and ended up winning the Super Bowl. So the week of rest should do Philly good. And the last time they were the one seed, a lot of folks doubted them, and they won the Super Bowl.
Yep.
San Francisco. It's got to be Brock Purdy, right?
Yeah, he's the question, but boy, has he answered it so far.
What quarterback, with respect to Brock Purdy,
of course,
what quarterback that had several games with Kyle Shanahan has played bad?
Not a one.
Right. And that's not a knock on Purdy. That's just a fact.
And some of them have played boring. Like Garoppolo is a boring quarterback. But
got him to two Super Bowls.
Exactly. I guess the thing that
people get excited because, oh my God, Purdy threw a few long ones. I'm like, ease up, like pipe down.
What I will say though, to Brock Purdy's credit though, some of the balls that he threads are incredibly accurate. Because here's the thing, like the offense is set up really really nicely for him. His receivers are built to get open really easily. But you see, he's made some tough throws, and he's made some throws that were not clean for anyone. But he put him in the right spot.
Playoffs are a different animal, though, right?
They're a different animal. They absolutely are a different animal.
Down the stretch, I mean, they played the Commanders, they played the Raiders, they played the Cardinals.
That's why it kind of gave that. But confidence is king, man.
And they get Seattle, who they beat by 8 a month ago. Seattle, their biggest question mark, I would say certainly the house money aspect.
Sure.
Like, holy cow, we got here.
Geno Smith ain't right back, though.
We got here. We got to the playoffs.
Getting right back.
No one invited us.
No.
No one wrote us an invitation.
Nope.
So
we didn't write back, and we just showed up anyway.
Yeah, I think.
Is the
question mark with the Seahawks is they're the Seahawks. They're
is
probably,
Ken Walker healthy?
You know, they're just.
He is. Okay, so Ken Walker's off the injury list. I mean, he's incredible.
I hope it would be. But if Geno just has a game of the ages,
that
goes off,
nuts,
and they
dude.
Beat the Niners.
That would be nuts.
I would like it. The Niners have won 10 games in a row. That is,
yeah, they're
that's something. That's
they're
something.
Incredible.
10 in a row. All right, Tampa Bay, last one. What's their biggest question mark? It's their O-line, right?
Their O-line. How they protect
their O-line, and how conservative will Todd Bowles be?
Oh, my God.
Bruce Arians was the opposite of conservative.
Watching the Bucs play football is the worst thing.
Speaking of point differential, do you know who had the worst point differential in the NFC South this year?
The Saints.
The Bucs. Saints
what?
Actually had the best. Saints were minus 15, Falcons minus 21, Panthers minus 27, Bucs minus 45.
What?
That's... Their defense has some problems, man. Defense has some problems.
I'm just looking. Almost every game they win, they're not even past like 21 points.
Look at the games they lost. I mean, they went to San Francisco and got punked by like
they did. They
28.
Got pummeled. Yeah,
like they're
the Panthers.
The Panthers
beat them down.
Tampa's just not good. I think their question mark is that they're not that good.
They're not good. They're not a good football team.
If your O line's good enough to protect Brady, he can nickel and dime you, and that's not. I get that he's Tom Brady, but at this point in his career, and it's, you know, nickel and dime you, and oh, now let me try one to Mike Evans because I've been getting you underneath all day. It worked. You over pursued. You got too aggressive. Yeah. Now we're putting up points.
It's a simple
other team
simple
turns
theory.
It over a couple times. We win a close game. Like that's the formula right now. But you know, they have a losing record.
Yeah.
There's one team in the entire postseason. The entire postseason with a losing record.
Yeah. Anytime a team requires mistakes from their opponent to win, you're not a good football team.
Only team with a losing record in the playoffs. It's not really a question mark. The concern is, well, they're not good.
They're not good.
The record says as much. They're not playing any NFC South teams, which the weirdest thing about Seattle, they're in the playoffs. Good for them.
Yep.
They're 9-8.
Yep.
They went 0-4 against the NFC South.
They did.
I don't get that. How? How did they do that?
Ultimate playing down to competition.
If you were like, all right, between Seattle and Denver, this Russell Wilson stuff, one team's going to be drafted in the top six, the other's going to be in the playoffs. Like, oh, well, obviously. Denver's getting in, and Seattle's, you know, they're going to be one of the worst teams. So, yeah, no, it's the opposite. Who would have predicted that? Bottom of the hour. That is a look at the questions for each team in the NFL Super Wild Card Weekend. Nick will tell you he kind of teased it, but maybe he has some other ones. Wild Card teams that could upset. We'll talk some hoops. Pels play Celtics tonight. UL men hit the road for the next four. We'll get a little bit into that. It's all coming your way on the Great Scott Show. 103.3 The Go. Oh, one more thing coming up. Proof that Kirby Smart is great at brainwashing his players.
I know exactly.
I mean, great.
I know exactly what you're going to talk about.
At brainwashing his players. Which I don't blame him. If I could,
can't wait.
I mean, it's a great formula
that
if you have a good team.
Oh, it's so funny.
All of that coming your way. Don't go anywhere.
If it wasn't for goats, we wouldn't have coffee. Look it up.
I'm gonna get some coffee. You want some coffee?
No, thank you. I'm fine.
And the best sports talk in Acadiana. 103.3 The Goat.
Welcome back into the Great Scott Show. Talk a little hoops coming up in about 12 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
A little more football for you. Super Wild Card Weekend. Wild card teams you think will win?
You asking me?
Yeah.
Giants.
So you got one.
I got the Giants, and I was going to go into why I think the Giants are going to win first, but let's go ahead. However you want to do it.
I mean, you go ahead. I think
the Giants, and I think the Chargers have the five seats. Yeah, I think the Chargers have
they're any non-division winner, even though they have a better record than Jacksonville.
Right, yeah, I keep confusing me because I'm just looking at the schedule.
I can't believe I'm going to do it. I think the Cowboys are going to win, which is ridiculous.
I shouldn't even say it.
Like,
yeah.
It's more about Tampa than it is Dallas.
Exactly.
Dallas, by the way, has not won a road playoff game in the 21st century, guys.
Wow.
Okay. It's been a long time. Anyone that thinks
21st century
the last time,
new.
Yeah, the last time they won road playoff games, you go back to the 90s, early 90s, by the way. Cowboy fans think they're about to win three in a row.
Yeah.
And then go to the Super Bowl. Like, come on. It's not happening.
This isn't
like,
even the best team the Cowboys have fielded in the last 5 years.
But they're playing, like, everyone's all wrapped up in Brady. Tampa's just not good.
Yeah, Tampa's not
They're
a good
the
team.
Worst team they're not in the field. Team. They're the worst team in the field.
Yeah.
They have a losing record. They were outscored by a ton this season. So that it's more about Tampa. That's my reason for picking Dallas.
Can I be straight up with you?
You know,
the reason I didn't pick Cowboys as my wild card team to win was because I thought it was such a foregone conclusion that I wanted to pick someone interesting to talk about.
Oh, well, okay. So you're really confident. You're too confident about the Cowboys.
No, I'm that unconfident in the box. I know how bad they are.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the Chargers against Jacksonville, I think the spread in that game is...
Chargers have the spread. They're favored by a point.
So we won't count that. Why do you like the Giants?
I like the Giants because, first off, the Vikings just, people have been saying it all season, and then the Vikings keep proving them wrong. But I think this is when it finally falls apart. The Vikings are frauds. They won't be able to win the game that matters, and this is why. This is where that game is. And I think Brian Daboll has got to be front runner for Coach of the Year.
Yeah, he's got it.
He's making Daniel Jones look like a starting caliber quarterback in the NFL. And I think they're going to just pound and pound the ball control. Keep the ball out of Kirk Cousins and Justin Jefferson's hands, and I think you do fine.
I like Minnesota, but I think they get annihilated and embarrassed the next week.
That's fair.
The Giants, I'll take the Cowboys, regrettably.
Yeah.
There are 12 teams that have never won a Super Bowl. Five of them are in the playoffs this year.
Wow.
Five of the 12.
Good odds.
Bills, Bengals, Vikings, Chargers, Jags. The obvious pick is the Bills as far as who could break it.
Yeah.
But rank them. Bills.
Bengals.
Put the Chargers ahead of the Vikings?
I would.
Chargers. You put the Jags ahead of the Vikings?
No, I put the Vikings.
Vikings,
ahead of the
Jags.
Yeah.
I think
just because the Jags are a little too young.
I think
they're still too young.
I think I'd put the Vikings ahead of the Chargers just because they'll at least be at home. And then if some weird shenanigans happen, if Seattle somehow, like, there's a scenario where Minnesota could stay at home. Probably not going to happen, but that scenario is at least in play. The Chargers, I mean, I don't, you know, no.
I think.
No, and even if they were some wild thing where they end up at home in a championship game because a 6 or 7 seed made it, which isn't going to happen, then, you know, it's just not going to happen, period. Then you would be looking at, like, they're not going to play Baltimore. Like, in the AFC, Baltimore and Miami aren't winning. So, like, the Chargers, and even if they did get home, it'd be a road game anyway because it's the Chargers. So.
Right.
I would put Minnesota slightly ahead, of course.
That's fair.
Really, Buffalo and the Bengals have a shot. The other three don't.
That's fair.
Do you know the other ones? Could you guess a few? Teams that have never won a Super Bowl.
I know the Texans.
There's six.
Falcons.
There's seven.
We did this before, and you got disappointed in me because I couldn't pick them.
Well, I spotted you five this week.
You did.
There's another team in the NFC South that has never won one.
That's the Panthers.
Right. There you go.
Think of two franchises that have been bad
for a long time.
One of the New York teams has never won one, but I was thinking it's Buffalo is the team that hasn't won one because the two New York teams already did.
One of these teams we root for, one of them we don't. They've both been bad for a long time.
One of these teams we root for, one of them we don't?
I doubt you root for one of these two, and you do like one of the other two, because America kind of liked them.
Oh, of course, the Lions.
The Lions.
And then the other one that we don't like? I already said the Falcons.
Cleveland.
Cleveland, yeah. Of course, they've always sucked. I forgot about that.
And they won a good bit of NFL championships before it was called the Super Bowl.
Yeah, that, by the way... Or Bernie Kosar. What's $19,000 on a game to get fired and then loses it anyway?
$19,000, which he was going to give to charity. He had no idea. The dude, like, put it, like, midnight, I'm making the first bet in Ohio. Let's film it. The NFL's like, he can't. Now, he was only on their pregame show. Like, it's not like that's where a lot of his income was coming from,
correct.
But it still was like, Bernie, bro. The other team that you didn't mention was the Titans.
The Titans,
which go back to Houston Oilers / Tennessee Titans.
Right. Okay, that makes sense.
Never done it. Oh, and the one other one is the Cardinals.
Of course, the Cardinals, because we were just talking about how they've had all these.
Been around a long time.
Never won a lot of games. Oh, that's because I thought about them in the Super Bowl with the Steelers, but they didn't win that game.
Yeah.
Lamaloo.
All right, let's look at Kirby Smart. 47 years old. He's got his team totally brainwashed.
He's 47?
That's it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, Georgia is the team.
Oh, boy.
See, and David Pollack say, yeah, this is the team in college football, the powerhouse. You know, they're owning it. And Nick Saban. Saban looks sad, but I bet you, dude, inside he was probably
he's
like.
Furious.
Oh, no, the competitive fire, he's like. I'm not going to say the words that were being said inside his head, but he's like, okay. I'm going to be here next year. It's not going to be on this set.
That's he's going to be, he's gonna be eating his little Debbie cakes with fervor in the morning.
Fervor. Yes, that's right. There were multiple players for the Bulldogs after they finished an undefeated season and won the national championship. We're 65-7. I only saw these clips on social media after the game because I was not watching the game when it was 65-7.
Oh, no.
There were multiple players that essentially, I won't use the exact words, but were doing the no one believed in us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To all the doubters. There were some players that literally said, man, there were so many saying we're going to be 6-6, 5-7, how you like us now? And I'm like, no. They said that about TCU, the team you just annihilated that no one thought would be. You're the dominant team. You're the Georgia Bulldogs. And I remember like...
odds-on favorites at the beginning of the season.
I remember Teddy Bruschi back in the day when the Patriots had a string of 3 Super Bowls in 4 years and, you know, may have been filming some other teams and whatnot illegally, but that's not the point. The point is, I remember him after some of the games being like, yeah, man, I mean, everybody doubted us. No one thought we'd win. It was like, you might not have been like the overwhelming betting favorite, but you were like, before the season, you guys were like top 4.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
If you... everyone, like,
could you imagine?
But they would do it a lot. And at some point, I was like, you know what? Like, maybe I'm looking at this the wrong way. Like, I players aren't watching and following sports the way we are.
Right.
Like, they're, especially during the season, they're just kind of in their cocoon with their team. They're getting this from their coach.
Yeah.
He's got them, whether it's one, two, three people, whatever. Now, when it comes to Georgia, though, like, it's somehow it's not even close to what the Patriots were doing because there was an element of they would beat Peyton Manning in the playoffs, and a lot of people didn't pick him to win that specific game.
The NFL is always more competitive.
Sure, but it was still dumb. It's like, come on, bro. Most people did not doubt you. Like, you were expected to be a contender and all this other stuff.
Right.
For Georgia... for the Bulldogs, for players to say, man, so many people saying 6-6 and 5-7. I'm like, Kirby Smart has them completely brainwashed. He's got them believing that no one believes in them outside of those in the building. And now if you really want to convince like a young player, yeah, you can find some jabroni or bot or egg or dumb fan on Twitter or one quote analyst that covers some team in another state saying they don't believe in him, or Cowherd or whoever has to pick a team and decide. Like, if you can find it, even though it's not even based in reality, these people are just saying it for clicks. But to say 6-6 and 5-7, like, it is in the amount of players that were doing it, I'm like, this guy's got him. Good job, Kirby.
Yeah.
Because God.
This is the kind of guy, like, he just won 65-7 in a national championship, his second in a row.
They've won 25 of the last 26 games.
Primed to win a third one. And he opened his press conference by saying that, hey, the team can't get complacent. We can't let this, you know, sometimes you get a sense of entitlement and you get too comfortable, you can't get complacent. Dude, if there was ever a time to be complacent, it is this moment in time. You don't have to prepare for next season right now. You just won the game at second.
I mean, you can't even.
It's been over for minutes.
You can't even put the 24-hour rule when your offseason's about to start.
We haven't. You haven't put the trophy down yet. You still have to build the cabinet for it.
That is why he is the ultimate. That's why he's the Saban protege that has had.
He is incredible.
Like, the success.
Yeah.
He's
best
got
time
them,
out in college football history last week.
He's got them believing that no one believed in him.
Oh, yeah.
It really is. All right. We're going to shift gears to hoops in just a moment. We'll
basketball
take a quick
time.
Phone call. Welcome into the show. Go ahead.
Hey.
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 That's the media's fault. The coaches use it, but the media is the reason why they can use that kind of stuff.
What do you mean it's the media's fault that a guy on Georgia thinks that the whole world thought they were going to go 5-7?
The whole world is against us, and the reason is because everybody knows that Georgia's the team that everybody's already bought in on, so now they go and try to pick that next team.
Well, I mean, you're using the
Georgia
game. I suppose you're using the media very loosely here, but like, yes, wait, Kyle. There's a difference between, man, we weren't picked to win the national championship, and man, everyone thought we were going to go 6-6.
Yeah,
like that's. That tells me that he had them brainwashed.
Well, that's a little.
That's a lot, man. That's a lot. If Kirby wants to be like, hey, this national guy, he said we wouldn't beat Ohio State, and now he's saying, okay, yes, you found one guy that probably doesn't even believe what he's saying. Man, no one believed in us this whole season. Like, stop it.
You know what's my biggest nightmare scenario in the NFL playoffs?
What's that?
Is that somehow the Tampa Bay Buccaneers end up worming their way into a Super Bowl win again.
They won't.
And Tom Brady, and you hear Tom Brady come out with that kind of crap, and I'm just going to want to, I don't know if
won't
I'll
happen.
Be able to ever watch
the
television.
They're not winning the Super Bowl.
I'm satisfied that it won't happen. But man... Oh, man, the cigar store Indians and the do-nothing Buccaneers. I could just see it right now.
He said Buccaneers, by the way.
Okay.
So Nick looked like you just put an F in front of it. He didn't say what you think he just said.
No, I said S with an S.
Heard like, that, 10-4.
Yeah, like see you, Buccaneers, because but I could see them putting together a four-game mini run.
Nah.
Just playing just good enough and just making me want to throw up every step of the way. But they would do that. That's exactly the thing. Nobody believed in us, blah, blah, blah. And then you'd hear the Tom Brady worship hit even a higher crescendo than ever before. Because every time that sorry old man wins the game, what happens? You hear the cockroaches come out of the cupboard from all over the media and start praising this guy again. And I ain't talking about necessarily you, but you know, you got your Skip Baylesses of the world, and you know who else, you know, all the other guys, Stephen A. Smith, who would just sit there and wash the man's feet if he came to their house for dinner. So I gotta let you go, brother. But hey,
thank you, Kyle.
I would tell you this is the worst ever I've ever seen the NFL be to have teams in the playoffs. And y'all mentioned why later.
Yeah,
the NFC is just like
it's just not good.
But if you get to the Super Bowl out of the NFC, it just takes one game.
Yeah.
Ball bounces your way, win the turnover battle, and suddenly,
ta-da.
All you got to do is get there.
Yeah.
Let's talk some hoops for a minute. It's so hard to win on the road in college basketball.
It is.
Are the Cajuns going to do it this week, the men? Women got a 20-point road win on Saturday.
Way
Shout out Coach Broadhead. Yes, had him on the show yesterday. But you're looking at a Cajun team that looked great at home last week. Mm-hmm. Looked great. Two close losses on the road.
Yeah.
Didn't get to the line a lot.
No, they didn't.
You're going to ULM. You're going to set. You've got games this week and next week on the road. My thing is, if you can just split, then I think you're in good shape.
Yeah,
and I know that's not satisfactory for some folks, but if you can split the next four, I think
if you split the next four, I would say you're happy and beat ULM. I think that makes that should make the average fan happy. I mean, it's a tough conference, man. Sun Belt's a tough conference, a lot of good teams in it. But I mean, this is a squad that they're finding their rhythm, they're finding their balance of, you know, who's going to go off this night, who's going to be able to distribute the ball, they just got to get to the line. They got to play clean basketball. They got to make shots. I mean,
they've got talent, man.
Yeah.
They've got a really, as far as the Sun Belt goes, especially when, you know, Dow Court, Falks.
Oh my gosh.
Garnett, when they're when they're shooting it the way that they are.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, look, you win at ULM, then you got South Alabama on Saturday. You come home for a little bit, you hit the road again. It is a, this four-game stretch, man, ULM, South Alabama, then Arkansas State and Texas State. And Coach Marlin was talking to me yesterday on the show about, you know, the committee maybe wanting to, the Sun Belt coaches wanting to maybe change a few things about how the travel schedule is laid out. They're still trying to figure some things out. It's weird when you look at it across the board this year. All right. With that, Pels tonight, coming off a 20-point win against the Wizards. No Zion, no B.I. They probably won't have him on, speaking of road trips, longest road trip, one of the longest road trips of the season. They're away from New Orleans for 10 days. They're kind of right in the middle of it right now. And they're playing at Boston tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Boston was one of, you know, they got the best record in the league. They handled the Pelicans. Last time they played them, it was in New Orleans, where the Pels are really good. 17-5 at home, 8-11 on the road. I don't think the Pels are going to be winning this one here tonight.
No, I think it's a tough sell. I mean, the Boston Celtics always good at home. Boston sports fans are intense, and you know, BI still can't really quite get on the court. He's still out. So I think maybe with BI in, they got a shot. You know,
to me, I think what you need to do while these guys are out is win the games against the teams that aren't great.
I agree.
They gave it a good shot against Brooklyn, and they were at home. Brooklyn had won, you know, 12 or 13. I mean, Kevin Durant was still playing. He's hurt now. And then the next night, you had to go to Dallas less than 24 hours later, quick turnaround. Dallas was red hot. I mean, that's a game where it's like, that's going to be tough to win. Now, you're at Washington Monday night. By the way, CJ didn't play against Dallas. Nice move by Willie Green. He just said rest. CJ looked really fresh against Washington, and he and Jonas balled, and they won.
Yeah, they did.
But Washington, that's a game you can win.
Absolutely.
They won it.
Yeah.
Boston's going to be tough. Not saying you can't win, but you got to be realistic.
This is a team, yeah, they can't play down to their competition. You gotta play your ball, and you gotta win against the guys who you're supposed to win against, and then everybody else, you deal with those as they come.
Here's what you got. So you got Boston tonight, then you got Detroit Friday. Can't lose to Detroit.
Can't lose Detroit.
Monday is gonna be tough, but you at least have a few days. You play Monday, it's MLK Day, so you play a 2 at Cleveland. Cleveland's good. And it's late. It's the last game of a long road trip.
Yeah.
Then you come home, you got Miami, then you're on the road against Orlando and Miami. And then you're at home for a little while. To me, this road trip, it's a success if you beat the Detroits, if you beat the Washingtons, and if you can steal one more.
Yeah.
You can steal one against Boston and Cleveland, then it's a big success. But just don't lose the ones where, even without your key guys, you got enough depth to beat these teams.
Yeah. I think that's the way to do it.
Get it done.
Yeah.
Get it done. Nick, thanks for coming in.
Absolutely, man. Anytime.
That was fun. Time flies by. You learned about the Real Superstore today.
Hey, yeah. I'm going to have a super rest of my day.
Dan Patrick's show is next. Don't go anywhere. James Butler in studio tomorrow with me. Can't wait to do that. 103.3 The GOAT simulcast on 1420 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.